take a minute while Simon's setting up to basically tell you why we're together here. Back in 2010, the official memorandum of understanding was created and signed by the National Park Service in the Midwest and Southeast regions, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service in both those regions, and an organization called the Mississippi River Trail Incorporated. And we together decided that it was time for us to kind of coordinate our activities with regards to recreation and conservation. And since then, we've added another organization that some of you may be familiar with, an organization called the Mississippi River Parkway Commission, which is the organization that oversees the Great River Road. They are a formal signatory now on the MOU. And then there is another federal agency that, although they haven't signed on the dotted line yet, has done a lot of work to support the efforts of the collaborative. That's the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. So basically, again, the concept is that we're just going to kind of coordinate and work together on conservation and recreation activities. And we've done a lot of neat things. It was the collaborative that brought about an event 4 years ago called Summer Paddling, where we basically coordinated 300 paddling events up and down the Mississippi River. It was followed by the Summer of Cycling, which the Mississippi River Trail folks took the lead on. 2014, we kind of looked at the year of geotourism to try and get this up and running. This year, we're in the midst of something called the Summer of Fishing. And again, we're coordinating fishing events and just kind of consolidating them and announcing them up and down the Mississippi. So another thing that we basically found out about when we were all together at our annual meeting in 2013 was something called geotourism, a National Geographic approach to geotourism. I'm not going to steal any of this guy's thunder. I'm just going to tell you what this is all about. But what I'm just telling you is how this came to the Mississippi. The collaborative got very, very excited about the concept of basically being able to do a geotourism initiative for the entire Mississippi River. And we are looking at the entire river from its source to its mouth, and branding this under the National Geographic logo. So the collaborative basically started pulling together the resources to make this happen. This is kind of neat because this basically is being offered to all of you to participate in at no cost, because it's the collaborative that's raising the money basically to develop the tools, the website, the map guide, some of these other things that are part of this whole process. And again, Simon will explain a little bit more. So that's kind of where this came from. And again, I represent the National Park Service, and I'm a member of that collaborative that we're talking about.
So I can start talking, and we'll pull up the PowerPoint once we get it going. So as Rory said, my name's Simon Jones. I'm here representing National Geographic. But I wanted to give you a little bit of information about what the geotourism program is within National Geographic. Then a little bit more about exactly what we're doing on the Mississippi River, and then we'll get into, hopefully the we can show it by then, we'll get into how to make an actual nomination and how to upload content on the website. So as Rory may have already said, this is a free program. It's took us about a year or more to kind of fundraise for a number of different partners, from private and public, all contributing to it. So the question we often get right at the beginning is, do we have to pay to be on the site? You don't. It's about a two-year program to develop this site. We have done this in over 20 destinations over the last 10 years. We started with print maps about 10 years ago, and are now focused mainly on online interactive platforms, websites. We also do apps and print maps still and other things. So within National Geographic, the National Geographic is a scientific nonprofit focused on telling the story of different places and explorations and discovering the world and telling that story. So this program is kind of our own way of telling a story of places. Tourism within National Geographic is kind of National Geographic's way of defining of tourism. Sustainable tourism, ecotourism, but it's tourism that represents the unique and authentic story of places. It's not about me from Nat Geo or someone else coming in as a third party and trying to write a guidebook about your place. What we want to know is what's your story, and we want you to tell your story in your own words about unique, local, authentic places that you would recommend people to visit. So whether it's a burger shop down the road, or whether it's a great little B&B, or whether it's a little national park or other things, we want you to be able to tell your story, and others that may not be in the room today, but people from the region to tell your story about what's unique and authentic about your place. And ultimately what we provide is the platform to do that. We create a co-branded website where you can tell your story about why people should come and visit your community, the Mississippi River in general, your specific business or site or attraction. So when we get to the website, I'll show you a couple of examples, but along the Mississippi River, we started, as Rory mentioned, I think the initial conversation started back in 2013, but we really started this program at the beginning of this year. And we got a smaller number of individuals together to come together and help to kind of plan what the objectives were or the goals were of the program, and then what our overall geography is. So we're focused along the Mississippi River, pretty much any county that touches the Mississippi River, and any business, site, or attraction that's within those counties. If there's a business or site or attraction that kind of overlaps into a broader area or is still linked to the Mississippi but crosses it or touches it in some way, that's all fine. Broadly, it's about one county wide from the Mississippi River, from the south to the north. And we started in January. We launched the site a couple of months ago. So the site is up there. You can go onto the website, and I have some handout materials, and I'll pull up the website address itself. But you can go to the website now, you can see nominations. There's about 150, 200 nominations that are already up there. And you can kind of see what it's like. But the site right now is what we call a nomination site. So it's designed to really gather your information. So you can go on, you can nominate, and we can get your information, you telling your story about what's unique about your place. And it'll all be gathered in one place. So that we're going through this outreach, this kind of content gathering process through the end of this year. And then we'll go through a review process. So we'll fact check the information that came in. There'll be a kind of an editing process. And then by April next year, we'll publicly launch the site. So I have more of this, but we've done this program in many different destinations. This is a little hard to see, but we've done it internationally. We've done a whole bunch in the US. We had a program that ended last year in the U.S. Gulf Coast state, so kind of bookend the bottom of the Mississippi. We worked in Louisiana, Alabama, Mississippi, and Florida, and gathered about 2,000 nominations of unique places to see. So there, just as here, you get a lot of people going to places like New Orleans. You get a lot of people going to maybe Miami and other places, but it's all of the unique sites and attractions in between that travelers may not know about that we want to tell that story about. And each site, although they're all connected through one system, each site is unique. So one of our earliest programs was Yellowstone. And Yellowstone, the focus, the visual focus there is large landscapes, so big areas, big open areas you can go and explore. Another program we just finished in Eastern Sri Lanka was much more about culture. It was about the different religions that are in Eastern Sri Lanka and the cultural diversity that's in that destination. So each site, through the nomination process, so through this process we're going through now, tells its their own story about their destination. And what we'll end up with at the end of this year is hopefully a whole lot of nominations that we'll sort through, and we'll get the what will come out as kind of filtered to the top are different themes. So in some places it's about broad landscapes, in other places it's about religious diversity, in others it's about nature or history or culture or food. The Gulf States, there was a lot of music, was a big thing. So through the nominations we'll gradually gather these themes that will come out, and those will help to tell the story, the introductory story of the Mississippi River. So you'll have specific sites and attractions. You'll have, you know, Joe's B&B down the road and Sandra's Burger Shop and other places that are specific locations. But through all of these nominations, we'll start to tell a story of why you want people to come to the Mississippi River. And the great thing about the Mississippi River, I mean, Eastern Sri Lanka, very few people have ever heard of Sri Lanka sometimes, but also Eastern Sri Lanka. But the Mississippi River is a brand in itself. A lot globally, and especially within the US, people know the Mississippi. But do they know that they can travel and explore it? And what we want to do is try and tell that story of how you can explore unique destinations within and along the Mississippi River. So this is the website, screenshot of. It's mississippiriver.natgeotourism.com. So this is our nomination site. And I'm just going to skip through a couple here. So as I mentioned, the broad ethos of the program is telling your stories. We want to gather what's unique and authentic about your place, and you to be able to tell your story about what it is the reason for people to come. So broadly on the website, we make it as easy as possible for travelers to arrive, and it's probably very hard to find, but it's effectively we categorize all of this information into three broad categories. Places to go, where to stay, and things to do. So people want accommodations, people want things to do, and places to stay. So we categorize it in these three broad categories, and then within each of your nominations, we then allow the traveler to kind of find more information within it. We also, so this is the kind of home page, we also want great visuals. Travel today, the first thing people look at are either videos or pictures. So we want, and I'm not saying you all have to be National Geographic photographers to do this, we want your photos or your videos, but good visuals is the key way to start to attract people. So in the home page, we'll be showing your photos, your videos, we'll be rotating on just below the main top screen to engage travelers. That's the first thing that people will look at, and then they'll start reading the text or discovering a little bit more about your site or attraction. And then it's also about local people. It's about yourselves, it's about others up and down the Mississippi River telling a story. So we want to highlight yourselves. We're not requiring you to put a photo up and to put your name and photo up there, but if you would like to, we would love you on our site, because we want to show the travelers that this information is coming from you. It's not coming from me, who they don't know, and you know, I live in Washington, D.C., what do I know about Mississippi River? But it's coming from you and it's your stories. Process we follow is from now until kind of October, November this year, we want you to go to the site to upload your nomination. And that can be a site, attraction, a business, effectively places that travelers would interact with. It can also be festivals, it can be even legends and stories about your area. And upload it. So we'll get into this in a minute, but text, pictures, video, contact information, and where you are on the map. And that's our way of your way of telling your story to the traveling public. What we'll then do is we'll review it initially. So if you upload today, within the next month or so, hopefully less, but it varies a bit depending on how much content is going on site. It will be reviewed to make sure you have those four major pieces of information. Do you have description of what your site is? Do you have pictures or video up there? Do you have contact information? Are you located on the map? Do you have a place? If you have all of that, you'll go up on the site. So you can see there's 200 odd nominations that are already live on the site. At the end of this year and the beginning of next year, we'll then go through a second review process, and that's where we look at, we do a little bit of editing of the text, so grammar or some other things like that, but we won't touch the kind of core content of your text. There's we did this in the Bahamas, we finished it last year, and there's a great nomination of this guy, Bonefish Duck, who's a bonefish fly fisherman tour guide. So he takes people out, they go fly fishing. And his entire nomination is written as, "I'm the bonefish dog. I go out and I take you fishing and you'll find the fish." And it's written like that. So other than a couple of grammar edits that we did, we left it as is. Because the traveler, they want to know that story. They want to know that, okay, this guy actually wrote his nomination. It wasn't some editor from National Geographic, and he's real. So we will play around with a little bit of, in terms of grammar and things like that. And you may get, if you put a nomination up, you may get an email from one of our editors just asking you to clarify something here and there. We will also fact check it in that second round in terms of, are you what you say you are? You know, if you're saying you're a fine dining restaurant and you are actually McDonald's, we may come back to you on that one. But so we do a bit of fact checking, and then they'll go live on the site. So it is your writing and other than a little bit of editing, will be up there.
That's a question.
Certainly.
How do you edit for obsolescence?
For obsolescence, you mean?
Something goes out of business.
Yeah. So we, and I apologize, I kind of missed that at the beginning. So at part of the beginning of this program, at the beginning of this year, we had this smaller group, which we call a Geotourism Stewardship Council. So these are individuals that are involved in tourism kind of along the Mississippi River. That entity, that kind of group of individuals may change a bit as we move forward. People may be added, people may be switched out, and those kind of things. But those are what we call our local editors. So
that's the biggest problem for projects like this.
Where the information 2 years from now is half of it's out of date. Yeah. So there's a number of different ways we try and it's not perfect, nothing ever is, but we try and avoid that.
We'll keep up with it.
Yes. The first is we ask individual nominees, so as a, and we'll look at this in a minute, but as someone who's nominating a site, you can log in now and review your nomination that you've made. You can also log in 2 years from now and keep your own nomination up to date. So each person that's nominated a site or even a couple of sites, you can go back in at any time, upload new pictures, change the, you know, festivals is a great example of that. You know, change the, again, we had our festival last month, these are the new pictures from that festival, and this is the date for the one next year or 6 months from now, whenever it is. So we ask you to also go in and keep your content live. We also have this group of people from the Mississippi, that can, or along the Mississippi River, that are our local editors. So they, if you go in and change your nomination, let's say 6 months from now your festival is done and you upload new information. Once you upload that information, it'll go to an editor, and the editor will kind of review it and then turn it live. And the goal is also, as this program grows and continues, that we'll kind of keep an eye on content, whether it's been updated or not. And actually, in the back end of the system, we can see when the last time it was that it was updated. And part of actually the kind of National Geographic role moving forward is hosting and maintenance, what we call hosting and maintenance. So part of it is just physical hosting and maintenance of the site, and part of it is an annual review of the content to get a sense of, okay, yeah, is it, is not, have things been uploaded that shouldn't have been uploaded on the site and don't still fit with the brand, or also is a lot of the content hasn't really been looked at and reviewed in the last year.
Sorry.
So no, that's fine. It's a very good question. So that we try and kind of put in a system to at least keep it up to date and revolving. We also tied the website to a Facebook page. So the goal is also, you know, websites can become obsolete. So we try and update the content on the website, rotate new information on the home page, put events or other activities that are coming along. And also include it or cross-promote with a Facebook page to have more of the kind of real-time information that's coming up or a certain event that's coming up or activity that's happened or other things. Each site is different, each site has its own look and feel, but they are all interconnected. And actually we have a new system that we have for the websites that just went live a couple of months ago. So previously all websites were kind of hosted separately on URLs, on the addresses, but now they'll still have different addresses, but they'll all be under one, in one database. So ultimately, once we finish this program, we'll have probably 20,000 different points of interest. And the goal with that is you can go directly to the US Gulf Coast states and find your information, but if you're in the US Gulf Coast states and you're exploring that destination, you can also know that you're linked to the Mississippi and find other places for your next trip or continue your trip or other things. So the goal is to cross-promote, but also you'll have your own unique website that tells your story of the Mississippi River. And this is the website. So so the site itself, as I said, it has these three major categories, and the goal with this is to make it as simple for a traveler as possible to find information. And we'll dive into, this is subcategorized a whole bunch. Once you try and define, okay, are you an accommodation B&B, or are you a hotel, or are you a hostel? But we try and make it as simple as possible for travelers to find the information. Then, as I said, great visuals. We want pictures, we want videos. They don't have to be perfect, but we do want, this is all content that's up there right now, pictures that people, individuals, not professionals, have taken. So good pictures, good videos are key. We do want also yourselves, if you're willing, to put your, as you create your profile, to put your own picture up there and describe yourself a little bit, who you are, what you do, because we want that information as well. You don't have to do it, but if you're willing. I'm just kind of walking through what the site has right now, just to give you a sense of what it'll be. So once you have these three major categories, you can also click down and find additional information. So you want to explore communities, or you want to look at historical or prehistoric places or natural areas. So then you can click on those, and it'll categorize, and you can find information purely about natural areas, or you can also look for interactive maps. So you can click on the map and a little hard to see, but you can click on the map and find places all along the Mississippi, zoom in, see what's around, or categorize it by, okay, I'm looking for an accommodation, then I want to find other things around it. And your nomination, so your specific, you know, business or site or attractions page within the website, we look for this four major pieces of information: great photos or video, where you are on the map, text, and then your contact information. And again, that we're looking for rich information from yourselves. It's not about us coming in and telling your story. And as I said, it can be categorized. You can, the traveler and yourselves, when you put up the nomination, categorize which category you fit into, so it's easier to find. So ultimately, you end up with this nomination, and this is one that's live right now, just a little bit further up the Mississippi. So this is where a traveler or yourself, so you can go and look at this now, would land. So you can say, okay, I want to go to this scenic overlook. I want to see this, but I also want to look for other things to do around it. I want to find a somewhere to stay that night, or I want to do an actual activity on the Mississippi. So on the right-hand side, we also categorize things that are nearby, and you can refine that. You can say, I want to find things nearby by accommodation, or I want to find recreational activities, or other ways of refining it. But so here, you'd say, okay, there's a, I want to go paddling. So you can click on that, and this guy's put a video as his first image. So you could check out his video, he has other pictures, but you can also, and then if you scroll down, you can see kind of where he works. This is actually a paddle tour that goes up and down the Mississippi. But you can also find out about that person. So this is the person that actually made this nomination. And you can get a better sense of, okay, who is it? Who is he? What does he do? This is short. You can also add a little bit more text. And this is in addition to the actual just general contact information that's on the nomination. And then you can also leave comments. So if you've had a great experience, we want you to come back, leave a comment. Those are reviewed by the editors, but once they've been reviewed, they'll go live on the site. So within a nomination at the bottom, you'll see other travelers' comments about that site or attraction. So there is it's not it's not quite like some of the other sites where everything goes up there. There is a review process of those comments, but yeah, you'll be able to see what travelers say about that nomination. There's also an ability to like the nomination, so you can see how many other people have liked your nomination. We also ask, so what we often see is, you know, someone will put up a nomination and it's all these, you know, amazing landscape pictures, lots of big open areas or the river or the bridge or other things, but ultimately travelers want to connect with people. So we do want pictures of people in your in the pictures that you upload or the videos that you upload, and it helps to engage with travelers. So broadly, I've already kind of talked a bit about the process that we follow. We're kind of in at this phase right now in terms of gathering content. But once at the end of the year, this content will be reviewed, fact-checked, and then in April next year, we'll roll out the public site. So this is the timeline. We talked a bit about that. And now I was going to jump into the actual kind of nomination process itself. How to make a nomination and what that involves.
Right, Simon, let me just add one more thing. Just to emphasize the point, it's certainly driven from the bottom up. You know, we've got a wonderful website called nds.gov that tells you virtually everything you want to know about National Park Service sites nationwide. We will not be tapping into nds.gov to populate this site with the 19 National Park Service sites. Each superintendent has basically been put on notice that they need to go in just like you and put in a nomination through this process. And that's how this site is populated, really from the bottom up, not from mining someone else's material, not from even going to the Parkway Commission and looking at their website. They're an active partner in this. They're talking to people that they work with. So it really is a very much a bottom up process, and I just wanted to emphasize that.
And also, sorry, just to build on that very quickly, the you know, travelers today, they use more than one resource to find information. So they're not just going to go one place to learn about the destination they're going to travel in. So, you know, this website does it, you know, we often get a question, is this going to compete with my, you know, my town's website or my destination's website? And the answer is really no. People go to different places to gather information, and they're probably going to go to this site, they'll go to Expedia or Kayak or something like that to find, you know, book their hotels or other things, if that's what they want, or their car rental or other things. And they'll go to the destination sites themselves to flesh out that information. So it helps to steer people who are looking for who are gathering information in different ways and planning their trip to different resources. And the website also, so we don't try and control the travelers. The goal is, once you get to a specific nomination, so if your B&B or maybe it's the historic downtown in your town or your destination as a whole, you have your website on there. So after that, they can click on your website and go to your website. So the goal is to drive people to these places. It's not, other websites can often, you know, they want to control the kind of transaction part. There is no transaction part on this. So we want to drive people to, you know, your CVB or your downtown historic road site or your trail site or your B&B or other things.
Next one.
So a nomination, in very broad terms, a nomination is your site, your business, an attraction that you think represents your destination. So it's what's local and authentic about your destination. There's a geotourism, and actually in the system, so once it's a couple of slides from now, there are guidelines to nominating. So the type, so it kind of gives you a broad guideline of what kind of nominations we're looking for, but it is pretty broad. The geotourism program in general, the ethos is places respected and recommended by locals. So it's what you believe it represents your destination. So it's not necessarily the McDonald's, it's not the Holiday Inn necessarily, but it's that local B&B or that little burger shop that is unique to your place.
Well, but not everybody in every community agrees.
But if you
get multiple nominations for the same
area,
how do you pick who gets in and do that.
Sorry, you mean not, no, multiple nominations for one
site? City, yeah, may submit a nomination, but the B&B owner might submit a nomination.
For one site or for different places, you mean?
The city would do kind of a multifaceted nomination.
Mm-hmm.
Individual site.
Would do their own.
Do their own.
Okay. And both of those would go up.
They'll all be on
there. Yeah, they'll all be on there.
Okay.
And again, the kind of the broad ethos of this program, and again, is how the focus of the traveler, and I kind of missed that part at the beginning, but this program is focused on local and authentic places to see and experience. So the traveler we're trying to attract, or that will be attracted through this website, are not necessarily the people going to Vegas, or, well, I go to Vegas, I also go to these places, but yeah, the Vegas or the Disney World traveler looking for that kind of experience is someone that's looking for a local, authentic experience and to connect with local people. So we're not necessarily saying that some of these other activities are bad, but they just may not end up on the site. But in terms of the nominations that you're referring to, for one destination, you could have, you know, for your town here, you could have 10 nominations, you could have 300 nominations, as long as they're all unique things to do and experience and they represent your destination, they'll all go up there. And as long as they're not the same thing. You know, there will sometimes be a little bit of overlap. You know, one person nominates, let's say a state park, and then someone else nominates the same state park. When we get to the review process, we'll either combine those or sort that out so that it ends up being one nomination. But there's no restriction on the number of nominations you can put up there, or other people can put up there. The review process is more, is it local or authentic, and does it represent your place? And if it does that, it'll be up on the site. Who can make nominations? We look for anyone that really has a good knowledge of the destination. So yourselves as people that live in this region, we don't exclude people that are from outside the region. So if there's someone that has an in-depth, a historian that has an in-depth knowledge of the area, they can nominate as well. But what we try and avoid is, you know, travelers, someone like myself, I have no idea what's good, what's bad, what's ugly of the destination. So I wouldn't be the best person to nominate, but we're looking for yourselves and others that have a good knowledge of the destination. Now nominations, they fit into two broad categories. So for businesses, we ask that someone that is affiliated with that business makes the nomination. Now if they can be helped by others, we're not saying they have to be the only one doing it, but we really look for someone that either owns the business or manages the business or is involved in the business in some way to nominate. Other attractions, so that could be events, it could be other sites or destinations or scenic overlooks or really anything else other than a business, is a bit broader. Anyone can really nominate. If you have we did this program in Colombia in the San Andres Islands, and people were nominating their favorite beach or their favorite overlook, you know, anyone can nominate those things. But for specific businesses, and then also for things like some of the like national parks and others, it's the people that are involved in those that we ask that they put the nomination up. So the types of things that we look for nominating, again, it's places, it could be local cuisine, food, shops, restaurants, natural areas, locally owned businesses, distinctive wildlife. It can also be culture, history, events are a great way of highlighting your destination, but also stories. And stories are a little bit harder, but we had in the Gulf States program, we had musicians that nominated their band and uploaded songs about the region. We had some storytellers that were uploading their stories and kind of their interpretation of the region. So it doesn't necessarily have to be a physical site or a physical place, but really, again, just something that's distinctive about your area that a traveler can act on. So the musicians, obviously, you may not, you know, you may look at that nomination, you say, okay, what can I do with that? But the goal is, okay, you can find this band, they play every Thursday night at this bar or this restaurant or something like that. So it doesn't necessarily have to be just a physical location.
Is there a geographic limitation of the area? Because, I mean, like, we have the city and we have the county that has attractions that are within a certain distance or time, or how do you deal with that?
So for our for this program, it's one county wide from the Mississippi River. So anything that's within a county that touches the Mississippi River, it is fine, is great to nominate. If there's also things that kind of overlap a bit, in terms of they have a connection in some way to the Mississippi River, but they may, you know, go beyond just the one county line, that's fine as well. But broadly speaking, it's a county line. Okay, so how to nominate? So if you go to the website and scroll down a little, the top of the website is effectively just a bit of introduction to the region. But if you scroll down a little, there's this nominate your place. So this big green button at the bottom is where you can start your nomination. Now, next year, once we roll this out as a public site, the broad look and feel will keep the same, but we won't have the focus on nomination. So right now, this is what we call the nomination site, which is really focused on gathering content. This will change in the future. But if you go to the homepage and click on make a nomination, effectively it drives you to this page. So if you're coming for the first time, you're creating your first nomination, we ask that you create a user account. And we ask for three basic pieces of information. We want your first and last name, we want an email address, and you to create a password. And that will create your account to be able to manage your nominations. We also, so there's a number of check boxes here that is entirely optional, but we do ask that you click on the newsletter function. We're not going to spam you with 101 emails, but this is how we're going to communicate, for example, when the public rollout is, when the launch will be of the website, any other information about about the program in general. So it's a way of kind of keeping up to date what's going on. We won't send endless emails every day or every week, but it's just a way of keeping up to date. So once you've filled out those three pieces of information, if you hit submit, you'll be able to start to nominate. And actually, also, you know, the nomination process may take a little while. You may just say, okay, I'll start my text and I want to come back to it. Once you have created an account, you can log back into your account on the right there. So in fact, just your email address and password, and you can get back into your account. Let's see. So once you log in, and I apologize, this is Bahamas, but it's exactly the same system. It'll just have Mississippi along the top. So once you log in, this will be what you'll see at the top of the page. And what we ask is, when you're creating a new nomination, just click on Add New Content. Also, once you create a couple of nominations, all of your nominations will be listed here. So you'll be able to see what content you can edit and manage and play around with. You effectively, there's a button at the bottom that says Submit to Editor. So until you hit that button, you effectively, the editors aren't going to look at it. So you're not going to, you can come back to it as many times as you want, update it until it's ready and you're comfortable with it, and then submit to editor. Just quickly finishing up on that. One thing we do ask though, because Rory got 70 nominations last week, that you don't hit submit to editor until it is complete.
Right.
Because if it, you can still go back in and edit it after that, but Rory or someone else gets a notification that there's a new nomination in, and goes in and looks at it. And what we found in like last week, there's people have started their nomination, but they don't have any photos in there yet, and then, you know, they're still halfway through the text, but they hit submit to editor.
That's extremely important, because for those of us who are the content editors right now, we have extremely limited time to review those. proposed. I work with Corps Engineers, I have a full-time job, this is something I'm kind of doing in my spare time, right? So, yeah, it's very important, don't hit that until you're ready to do that. So, yes, I appreciate that question very much.
And just to give you a sense, I mean, the Gulf States, when we finished the, it's actually grown since then, but when we finished the program, we had 1,800 nominations. And we actually have over 2,000 that were actually submitted, but some of them didn't get finished. Three of those special interest groups nominated one site. And they're all slightly different, they're all three nominations. So we may come back and say, you know, can you guys sit down and coordinate for one of those? So there may be a bit of that, but you don't have to sit down and decide what goes up and what goes down.
Jim Dion, who some of you met, who is the other gentleman, National Geographic, who works on this, refers to this as the most cumbersome way to build a website out here. But the point that he's making is that, you know, it's because there are all these levels of review and detail and back and forth discussion. I mean, as an editor, I can open up your nomination, I can type in the comments, and that automatically generates an email back to you, or I'm asking for clarification on this, that, or the other thing. So it is a very labor-intensive process. But basically, on behalf of those of us who are receiving your nominations, you may get a few questions back and forth, but in the end, you really end up with a level of detail that, having explored a couple of these finished sites, I don't see anywhere else. I really don't. It's really a phenomenal process.
And it's a great example in the Gulf States program. We had the tourism folks in Louisiana come back at the end of the program and say, yeah, through this process, we discovered stuff that we didn't even know. And again, it's not, you know, in New Orleans, they may have not discovered anything new, but it's when you get out into some of the smaller communities and areas, I'm going to send you all home with homework today. So part of your homework is first to nominate, and then also to spread the word so that other people that may be interested in nominating or putting up a site, or have a business that's linked to tourism or involved in a site or attraction, nominate as well, because that's how we kind of get the word out and we really discover what is unique and authentic about your place.
Well, that prevents overwhelming redundancy. The community may include a site as part of it, put together again that multifaceted nomination.
Mm-hmm.
Then the individual owner of a facility might submit their facility. And I email twice. And then maybe somebody who has fond memories of staying there will submit. And now you have it a third time. I mean, the editor.
That's part of what we do. For example, we partner with the Audubon Center in West Alton. And so I went in and put in a placeholder for the Audubon Center. And when I went back in to do some editing, noticed that there was already another nomination for the Audubon Center that had been put in by staff at the actual Audubon Center. So I went and I deleted mine, because obviously the people that run the Audubon Center, even though I know a lot because we partner with them, they should be the one that has the power to nominate and control that content. So that's the other thing that's kind of important, is whoever nominates controls that content. So why would I go in and put in a National Park Service site when, I mean, you can do that if there's nobody else doing it, but if you know that Rory is gonna put in his National Park Service site, maybe a little bit of coordination to make sure the right person is working on that content. So it's not to say that someone outside of the realm can't do that. But yeah, that's something that the content editors need to review, and we kind of will handle if we think that there's two or three in there. Who's the best person? And then that's where we do a little bit of coordination to say, hey, the actual owner of this site has nominated that site, so we think we need to pull that out. It's not to say we may not want to pull some of your content, because you may know something that nobody else knew. So it's part of what we do on our end to help facilitate that.
And what we do ask is, you know, so in your example right there, where there's three different organizations that nominated. So the owner of that business and the person that really has fond memories of that experience of that business, if there were two nominated, and it does happen, it doesn't happen as much as you'd think, but it does happen, we coordinate with them, as Kim said, to kind of combine some of that information. But if it's the CVB or the kind of town nominating a whole bunch of sites, we do ask that the town, and I don't know the specific example, but let's say the your town wants to nominate. You can nominate your town as a nomination, but you shouldn't necessarily be going in and nominating, you know, Joe's B&B and...
Actually, we have a beautiful example. That's exactly what we're dealing with right now, because somebody basically dumped 70 entries into the submit, and by looking at these entries, it was obvious they weren't quite ready to get the submit key. You hit the save key, you're saving your information for yourself until you're done with it. You hit the submit key, you're giving it to us to look at. So that's the difference between those two keys. Well, we got 70 entries, basically, and most of them are from I'm forgetting the name of the town.
Galena.
Galena. Okay. Somebody basically put in 70 placeholders. Now, what they did do was they put their contact information in for each of those B&Bs and each of those wineries and each of those restaurants. So we have the right contact information. And our guess is, we got to get back to them and talk to them, but I guess Mrs. Kim's going to get saddled with this one, but our guess is that basically they, again, started this and they intend to reach out to all of these businesses and have them finish it off.
And that's perfectly fine, because, sorry.
That's all right.
So in that case, where someone has gone in as the CDB or as the kind of representative of the town, said, okay, they made for one nomination of this is our town, this is the history, this is why it come to our place, or historic downtown, or something like that. They may also put placeholders, which is Kim did for some of her destinations, for other places. In the site, and I'll get to a page that shows more of the whole page, at the bottom, you can add collaborators. So there's this button that says add a collaborator. So if you went in, for example, and you put 20 nominations in there for the 5 B&Bs in your town, and the 4 restaurants, and a couple of the sites and attractions, that's perfectly fine. But what we do ask is that you coordinate with those other individual groups. And you can add them as collaborators. So you can go to Joe's B&B and say, look, I set up your site, I put your basic information up there, you're a collaborator now on this nomination, and Joe can go in and edit the nomination just as you have access to it as well. So that as long as, at that level, as long as we'd ask that you do collaborate locally, but otherwise you can nominate your own sites or other sites and attractions that you have. So there's what you can't see on this is the overall banner of the kind of Mississippi River Geotourism Program. But below that, this will be whatever picture you decide is your nomination, your primary one. And then you can scroll through, if you've got 10 pictures up, you can scroll through 10 pictures or videos or whatever else. But yeah, this will be your site on nomination.
Are there minimum and maximum file sizes desired on pictures?
There are, so the system will compress, like for uploading an image, for example, will compress it, but, and we were just actually discussing this a little bit earlier, professional photographs are often like 10 megs and above. So it struggles with those. If it's, 1 megabyte, 2 megabytes, 3 megabytes, whatever size that is, it can kind of handle that, but
What you can do if they're professional photographs, and the site will actually tell you you can't upload them, what you can do is you can open them in Photoshop and decrease the resolution. So like the photographs I uploaded were 300 resolution, and I took them down to 72, and then they're small enough to go on the site.
Yeah, so if they're really big file sizes, you have to play around with it a bit. But the majority of the photos that all of us use and take and other things, it shouldn't be a problem.
It's JPEG.
It takes a whole, I can't remember the list of the ones it does, but it tells you when you get into that. And actually, there's a screenshot of it here, but JPEG, GIF, some of the other.
When you get into the site, take advantage of whenever you see something in parentheses, because it explains everything. Okay. I don't know if you folks saw me looking at my text message, but I show off my cell phone to show you that I'm probably the least obvious version of you working a site like this, and I find it really amazing. And they explain everything. Even in each of the categories, there's a what's this, so accommodations, hotel,
And it was this, and there's a definition for every one of those categories to help you figure out how best to place them. There's information on the photographs, how to load them. I mean, and Simon's going to hit on this, but well, actually, he just did because there it is.
So I kind of skipped a bit. So actually, just give me 2 seconds because it makes a little bit more sense. So once you've clicked on this to add your nomination, it will take you to, this is, if you think about creating a nomination, there's a series of questions. This is the first question we ask. And this is important because it kind of defines then what questions you're asked after that. So we have this long, what we call this content list. So if you're in a combination, are you a B&B, are you a hotel, are you a hostel, if you're a national park or a protected area, what kind of protected area are you? So there's this whole long list that kind of helps to define what site of attraction or business you are. Are you a restaurant? Are you a fine dining restaurant? Are you a, a cafe? Are you a coffee shop? Or, there's a number of different options. So we ask you to select one of these as, let's say, your accommodation and you're a B&B. Then it'll take you to this site. So this page. So once you define what you are, and you can also, if you decide you're not what you, you got it wrong, you can go back and just click on here and change that. But the questions we ask, especially in the text, the rest of it is pretty much the same. But in the text, the types of content you can add vary slightly depending on what you selected. So if you're an accommodation, we ask certain questions. If you're a national park, they're slightly different. Kind of boxes to fill in effectively. But it'll take you here, and this is where you fill in your four major pieces of information. I'll go through that in just a sec. But on the, and this is kind of blown up from where it is on the site, but on the left-hand side of the site, there's also this document section. So there's two really useful documents that can help to guide you through developing your nomination. And they're PDFs, they're 2 or 3 page PDFs. The first one is the simple guide to nominating. So if you download this, it's a 3-page PDF that effectively takes you through the same kind of screenshots of how to create a nomination. So this is useful if, to kind of guide you through the process, the first one you did. There's also nomination guidelines, so that's where it gives you a bit of a sense of what kind of nominations we're looking for and what the nominations, what kind of nominations you get. So these two documents are kind of handy to help help guide you through the nomination process. Once we also get to the live site, so once it goes, it's converted to a public facing site, more documents will actually be added here that will give you a kind of guidance on, okay, this is how to use your nomination, ways in which to promote your nomination or to drive people to your nomination and update and edit your nomination. So this section on the left under documents, they're kind of useful resources. And then as Rory said, there's kind of helpful prompts, or at least we hope they're helpful, along the way that kind of guide you if you have questions about these things. So once you've selected, okay, I'm in an accommodation, I'm a B&B, the first place you start is, or the first place it sends you is text. You don't necessarily have to do these in this order, text, then media, then contact information, then map. But that's the first one it takes you to. So we ask you to fill in your title, so your Joe's B&B or whatever it is. And then there's different text box for filling out your description of your place, of your site for nomination. So as I said, for accommodations, there's different text box you fill out. For others, they're slightly different. So if you also have writer's block, I get this quite a lot, and you're not quite sure how you want to describe your B&B or how you want to describe that historic downtown, you can click on use prompt questions, and it'll drop down to give you effectively a number of different questions that you can just answer. And this helps to effectively, if you answer these questions, it'll kind of build your nomination through that. So it kind of guides you through it a bit if you need a little bit more kind of help with how to write your nomination. The other great way, so this is one way of kind of
figuring out what kind of text you want to put in there. Another great way, because there are 200 odd nominations on the site already, a good way is, okay, you're a B&B, have a look at some of the other B&Bs that are already on the site and see how they've described themselves. And don't copy it, but at least it gives you a sense of what, how other people have described what they are. We do ask, though, that we want engaging content. So we want more than just a couple of sentences about your B&B or your site attraction. We also don't need an entire essay about the place that you're nominating. But a good, you know, 3-4 paragraphs, more, obviously that varies depending on what kind of what the nomination is. But also the goal is you want to engage travelers. So you want to think about, if I'm a traveler, if you're a traveler, if you go to this nomination, what's going to engage that traveler and attract them to come to your site, the nomination, your business? So you want to think about, you know, what are travelers interested in, and how can you describe in your own voice, in your own words, what your nomination means to you and what it would mean to a traveler. And then we ask you to click save as much as possible. So at the bottom of every page, as you're creating a nomination, we ask you to click save, because if you're halfway through writing your text and the power goes out, or you accidentally close your browser, you'll lose your content unless you hit save. The other thing is, and this is a new thing with this new system, if you use Explorer as a browser, for some reason right now it's not saving. So any other, like Chrome or
Mozilla Firefox.
Mozilla Firefox or Safari or any of those other ones will do it, but Internet Explorer for some reason just doesn't like it. So it's just so that you know, because Kim went through this on.
Yes, I did. She was pretty up and there's nothing worse than entering all your stuff and hitting save and it just sitting there and not doing anything. So
other than that, you're fine. But just keep hitting save. So you can hit save if you put all your text in. You have a dinner reservation and you want to come back and put your photos and other stuff in later. Just hit save, close it. You can come back again. Just type in your email address and your password, and you come straight back to your nomination. If you want to continue once you finish the text, click save and next, and it'll take you to effectively the next section of content, which we're looking for, which is media. So media, we ask that you. I mean, the major piece of media is pictures and video. So we ask that you put at least, ideally, 3 or 4 pictures up there of your site or nomination. If you have a video, great. And the video doesn't, none of this has to be National Geographic quality. Don't worry about that. But a video, even if you have your smartphone, you take a 30-second scan of your B&B or the scenic overlook you're nominating or something else, that's great content as well, because it gives the traveler a better impression of what that place is. So videos, if you have them, are great. Images, again, you can put as many as you want up there. Some of the great nominations probably have 20 pictures and 3 videos. But you don't have to put that many up there. But we ask for at least 3 or 4.
When you change a photograph, that has to go back to an editor, is that right? Or an image, let's say.
So when you change, let's say you put up 10 photos and you, 6 months from now, you decide you want to take down 5 and upload another 5. Your nomination, so once the site goes live, your nomination will stay as it is until an editor's had a chance to review those changes, and then it'll be switched out. Yeah. And then, in addition to images and video, the site can also handle other files, other kinds of media. So actually on the video one, you can upload a video file. So you take it on your phone, you can upload that file to the system. You can also link an embedded file. So if you have a video on YouTube, or as an example today of you have a video in your website or something else, you can link that video to the site and it'll embed it in the site. So you can do it either way for videos. And then, as I mentioned earlier, so you can also upload sound files if you're a musician, or if you, even if you're a bar or restaurant and you have great music, you could upload sound files if you want, or storytelling, storytellers have put stories up there. And you can also upload PDF files. So restaurants use this a lot. Do you want to update your, or put up your menu? Festivals do it as well. You put up the flyer or the one pager about the festival, you can upload those as well. So you can put a whole bunch of different files depending on what you want. So if you click on images, and this is pretty much the same whether it's an image or video or other file, you click on it and this is where you can upload the file. So if you click on add files, you can go into your desktop or find the file that you want, click upload. We do ask that you put the name of the photographer. So actually, before that, when you click add files, it'll ask you for a description. So, picture of the Mississippi or Joe's B&B, front of Joe's B&B, or whatever you want to call it. But we also ask you to list the photographer. So it doesn't necessarily have to be you, but whoever took that photograph. And we also ask you to click on this, which effectively says that you have the right to upload that photo or that video. And the reason for that is we want to make sure that you actually do have the right to use that photo, and we're highlighting it as such. So once you've clicked on yes, this is my photo, or yes, I have the right to use it, who the photographer is, and the description, and then upload the file, click start upload. And then they'll pull that file up, but you can also add, as I said, as many images as you want. So you can just keep going and add in your 10 photos that you want of your destination. And I don't have a screenshot of this, but once you've added your photos, you'll see them all. There'll be a little thumbnail of the photo and the description that you gave of it. But often what happens is, you go to the folder that you have your 10 photos in, you click on the first one, upload that, second one, upload that, third, upload that. But that may not be the order that you actually want to a traveler to see those in, because the first image you have will be the image that shows up on the rotational piece on the home page. It'll also be the first image that shows up on the map when you click on the points and it pops up, as well as the first image on your actual nomination. So that first image is critical. You want your best image on that number one. So when you have your 10, when you've uploaded them, you can see your 10 images. You can change, you can reorder the number. So if you can go in and you want number 9 as number one, just put that as number one and it'll put it up to the top. So we ask that you just kind of review those to make sure that the picture you want as the first one goes up there. Once you put up some media, we ask you for contact information. And this is pretty basic, usual contact information stuff, website, email, a contact individual person if applicable, and then the mailing address. This is the public contact though. So you as a nominee may have a different email address, different phone number than you want in terms of publicly linked to that nomination. So here you may want that info@email and the general contact information for the park or the B&B or whatever it is and the website and those kind of things. So this is different from creating your account for that information you get from that. And then the last part of information that we want is, where are you on the map? And you can find that info, or you can upload and add that information in three different ways. If you're sophisticated, or if it's the kind of site that, if it's the kind of site that's not necessarily a mailing address, and we had one this morning where they were Indian mounds, so there's not a mailing address for that, it's the place. So you can upload a GPS lat long coordinate. You can also, just in Google, put in your mailing address and it'll find the location. Or you can open the map, and this is actually not the kind of map we use, but it's a basic Esri map. You can open the map and zoom in and find yourself and just kind of put a placeholder of where you are. So those are the three ways of putting yourself on the map. But there's also four different ways you can define yourself on the map. So the vast majority of places, it's a single marker, it's a single point. You are a B&B and you're here, or you are a historic site and you're you're in one location. Some places have multiple locations. So if you're a paddle operation and you have three locations where you can pick up kayaks and other things, you can put all three locations under one nomination. And so your three stores or whatever it is. Or like the San Andres example in Colombia, there are the five top windsurfing beaches that they wanted to highlight. So you could put all five under one nomination. Then the other part is routes and circuits. So you can also draw, if you have a driving route or even a walking route or other things, you can draw a route as your nomination. So trails, some of the historic trails, other things, you can put the routes on there. And then the last one is a geographic area. So if you're a national park or if you're an area that's bigger than just one point, you can also draw on the map where you are in terms of a broader geography. And then that will show up on the map. So those are the four major pieces of information. We want your text, we want your media, your pictures, we want your contacts, and we want where you are on the map. And then ultimately, this is what's created. You create your nomination. One of the things we do ask is when you're in the nomination phase, it's a little hard to see on here, but oh no, here you go. So on this one, at the top of the page, there's a link for a preview page. So obviously you don't want to do that right at the beginning because you won't have anything there. But once you've uploaded some photos and some text, maybe your other information, or you're about to not, you're in that stage where you're comfortable with it. If you click on preview page, it'll pull up a separate window that will show you what it's going to look like. So it'll show you, okay, this is what your nomination is going to look like. And we ask that you have a look at this before you submit to the editors, because what can sometimes happen is, okay, you click on preview this page and you realize, okay, I wanted a different picture in the front here. Or sometimes just because, the text you write in the box, is, let's say you put spaces between certain paragraphs or bullets or other things, because this is a template site for all nominations, it may look a bit funny. So just have a quick look just to make sure, nothing, as I say earlier, funky. All right, a couple of tips. I think we've covered most of this, but again, you want to inspire the traveler when they come to your nomination. So great images, a great first picture, and also content that will engage in terms of text that will engage the traveler to then click on your website or call you or come and visit your site. Again, please click save as much as possible because it saves you from a headache of losing all your content. We do ask you, again, that you kind of review your content and that all the four major categories are filled out to your, that you're comfortable with it, and then submit to the editor so that we don't get nominations that are kind of half done being submitted to the editor. At least four pictures, ideally, and a video. Again, the video is not required, but we want as much content, visual content, as we can get. And then once complete, submit to your editor. Your editor also may come back and ask you questions. So as they review it, as I mentioned earlier, there's two rounds of this. The first round is, do you have all the content? Do you have text? Do you have pictures? Do you have contact information, and are you on the map? Your editor may come back and say, can you add some more pictures or something like that. Later in the year and early next year, you may get contacted by a Nat Geo person that's asking the fact checkers. So they may come back and say, and ask you some questions just to clarify stuff. So you may get emails generated from the system as our editors go through. But other than that, and then once we get to April next year and the site is going to go live, what we also provide is a content packet. So every nomination that ends up on the site will get a packet of information. So it'll be, it's one thing, the Colombians, and we did this for like Sri Lanka as well, they like these very formal certificates. It probably won't be quite like this, but you'll get a certificate that says that you're a part of the geotourism program, that you're a nominated site. You'll also get a window sticker, which is kind of like a 4x4 sticker that you can put in your window that travelers can see. And then you'll also get a digital badge that you can put on your website, or you can put on collateral material you're developing, and print material and other things. And the goal of this is, so if someone comes to Joe's B&B, I made up Joe earlier apparently, but if someone comes to Joe's B&B and sees this, this is the Gulf States, so it'll obviously look different, you know, for the Mississippi, but if someone comes and sees this in the window of Joe's B&B, the goal is they look at the website, they find other things that are nearby and around, and then maybe as they're walking down Main Street, they see that, oh, this burger shack also has this, or this little shop, or this restaurant. So it helps to build the connectivity between all these places. So this will be provided as kind of a packet at the end when we get to the launch of the website. And with that, that's about it. Again, this is the website, and we ask you to nominate, and we also ask you to spread the word.
We should formally introduce Kim, because Kim is actually the one that's serving as the initial content editor for Illinois and Missouri. But Kim is the recreation manager with the Corps up in Alton. And then my job is, I get to be the assignment editor. I'm the one that basically, when your nomination comes in, I figure out what state it's in, and then I get to assign it to Kim and let Kim follow up with it. So I got a relatively easy task. Although I am the editor of all the federal nominations that come in as well. But so you see, it's a multi-level process. And again, this initial editing is aimed at just getting a lot of this stuff on the site. And as Simon has said a couple times, there'll be another whole editing process where they're really looking at content. Not so much to be critical, although there may be a little critical side to it, and make certain that the content, as Simon suggested, really fits into the concept of geotourism, just to make sure it's all complete. And again, I can't say this enough. It's your, Simon said it, I'll say it again, it's your site. Once it's up there, it's yours to maintain, it's yours to take care of. When you do make changes, it will go back into an editing process. So there'll always be somebody just kind of looking at it to make certain that something doesn't slip in there that doesn't fit into the concept, the geotourism approach, or that perhaps you missed something. I had one example the other day, and this is where I found out the communication platform within the system works. I was reviewing a nomination for a museum, and the gentleman didn't put any information in about accessibility. So I can actually go on nomination, I can type in comments, which actually goes out to that individual in the form of an email, and then that individual responded and said, oh yeah, we're all on one floor, and we even have wheelchairs that we loan out if people need them. Well, that was good stuff, and that was something they just neglected to put in there. So, you know, we're really trying to help you make this the most complete nomination possible.
And actually, I guess, sorry, to add one more thing, and then I really will shut up, which I forgot to mention, is within the website, and this is much more useful once it gets launched, but is this trip ideas and trip planning content. So as a traveler, as you go through, you see a nomination you like, there's a button on the nomination, you say add to my trip plans. So that'll automatically send it to your shopping cart, effectively. And then you can click on my trip ideas and see the places that you said, oh yeah, that looks good, that interests me. And then you can build itineraries around those trips. So that's as a traveler. But when all of this, when we get a little closer to the public launch, as a site or attraction or business, you can also create your own itineraries. And this is this site, this new platform actually allows you to do it much easier. But we did a program that wrapped up at the beginning of last year, Newfoundland, Canada, and there was a B&B there that just really used her site nomination to the best degree. So she had her, it was a B&B, she had a B&B. Whenever she got someone that said, you know, I'm coming, I want to stay in your B&B for 2 or 3 days, but what else should I do around there? She had created these itineraries on the site that allowed her to say, you know, go to my nomination, you can click on my itineraries, and you can see, okay, you have 1 day itineraries, you have 2 day itineraries, you have different options, different themes. So you can build, and this is good you know, anyone can use it, but especially if you're a business like a B&B or something like that, you can build your own itineraries and then use it as a promotional tool to say, if you want to, you know, come stay with me for 3 days, and here is a whole bunch of different ways you can explore the destination, and you don't have to repeat yourself 500 times as everyone asks the same question as they call you up to book your B&B. So there's different ways, and we'll get into this more once we get into the launch of the site, but there's different ways to use the site to help your business or site or attraction attract people and then help those people to find more info.
A question, say we have a historic site like an old cemetery, but we also have an event once a year, like a spirit meeting. Is there a way to link that event to the place page?
So, yes.
Special events.
Yeah, there is. So for that example, and there are often others as well where we really ask, ideally you create two nominations. So you create a nomination that's the historic site and a nomination that's the event. And the reason for that is people may be looking for events or they may be looking for historic, so you can kind of capture people in different ways. And then within the easiest way, quite frankly, to do it is put the website, you know, once you've created those nominations, is just create the link from one, put it in the text of the other. There is a way at the bottom, once you're nominating, there's a way of cross-linking them, but you have to have both created and those kind of things. But,
because that's a very common occurrence here with historic sites that have
special
events throughout the year.
Yeah. The other way it will be cross-linked, so it's good to make sure that's in your nomination for both of those two nominations to cross-link them. The other way that it'll kind of do it automatically as well is when you have the nomination, on the right-hand side, you saw the nearby thing. So we were actually in St. Louis talking about exactly the same thing, where you have the arch. So you have the arch, but you also have a museum, you have a number of different sites and events and other activities within that. So the system will automatically know they're all in the same place because they're all, you know, on the map, they're all close by. So in the nearby, you have your nomination, then there's a kind of section of the website to the right that has nearby things. So that event, you know, if you're on your historic site, that event will actually be in the nearby.
So we don't have to populate that?
You don't have to, although it's a good idea to cross link them, just to double it up.
Yeah.
But if you're in the same location, it'll pull it up as a nearby nomination.
Yeah, my guess is that after having this discussion earlier, the Arch is probably going to have somewhere in the neighborhood of 6 to 10 nominations. So that, again, people can get everything in there, but also, as Simon just said, people that are looking for different areas of interest can be directed to that site to see what they offer in that particular area. So,
people that, like me, that forget what the Arch is, who go look for a museum,
it's
and they're like, oh, there's an Arch there. It's
not a
museum.
Yeah.
Just be clear.
So if we don't have to populate that nearby, does that mean that Joe's B&B will have a nearby B&B
on the whole, no, although it is possible. So let me actually just see if I can run quickly back through to one. So this nomination, then you have contact information and nearby. On the whole, if you're a B&B, the nearby default will be sites and attractions. So it'll be recreational activity or whatever it is. But you can refine what this nearby list is. So if you, as a traveler, if you click on this and you want to look at other accommodations, it'll come up with other accommodations. Or you can refine to say, I want to look for restaurants, and it'll come up with restaurants. But the default will be, if you're a business, the default will be sites and attractions. But it doesn't necessarily mean that.
Okay. So the traveler might find that?
The traveler or anyone.
All the B&Bs within 5 miles will show up?
Yes. So if you click on, if this is a B&B and you click on refine and accommodations, it'll list the closest, it'll list them in order of proximity. At this stage in the, because we're in the nomination phase, it's not a public site. I mean, you can go to it publicly, but it's not promoted as a travel site. All the nominations up there, they've literally only been reviewed as, does it have text, does it have pictures or video or whatever, does it have contact information, is on the back. The process at the end of the year and beginning of next year will be then to refine and edit those.
If there's an item missing on a nomination and you've clicked submit to the editor but you forgot to locate it on the map, does the editor contact you and say you've got everything except you need to locate it on the map?
Yes.
Okay.
And
you bet we will.
So if you click submit to editor, that doesn't take it away from your account. So you can, if you click submit to editor and then suddenly 5 minutes later you realize, oh, I needed to add the location, you can go back in and add that and that's fine. But the editor, if it's not there, the editors, when they review them, will effectively get an email. They'll email you through the system.
Was there a way to hyperlink to a Facebook page rather than listing a website, or do you list the URL for the Facebook page under?
You can list your website, but there's also social media stuff.
You mentioned there's an area where people will be able to comment in the future. How will those be moderated, and will businesses or someone have a chance to respond to those?
Businesses can definitely respond. They will, so the first level of review is if you submit a comment, it'll go to the editors. So it'll go to, you know, someone on the team that's reviewing and editing the site. If it's appropriate, it'll be put up there. You know, if it is responding to a certain experience or something, it'll be put up there. Then the comment field, anyone can do, so the owner of that B&B or site or whatever it is can then respond with a comment.
So
they can also request for an editor to, you know, take it down if they don't think it's appropriate or contest it.